A big thank you to the Kaya Central team that, of course, is with Mo G. And normally I'd say he's back again with you tomorrow on the Top 40, but not so, because tomorrow we have Proverb that will be taking over the Top 40.
Yeah, Sean. Things have changed, and lots of people who will listen to Kaya FM 95.9 will know the man well because he has stood in for Mo G on one or two occasions. But people will be thinking, what's happening? Is the Top 40 idols now? Are we going to be calling in to... No, it's not. Proverb is welcome here at Kaya FM. He has been for a while, and he takes over tomorrow. And tonight, you've also got someone new.
And someone new this evening as well. That is Thomas.
Yes.
Well, back in the day, he was like Bad Boy T, but now I think he just goes by Thomas.
He's mature now. He's not Bad Boy T.
He's now at Kaya FM, so he's no longer a bad boy. He's no longer Bad Boy T, but he's with the Rhythm Sessions this evening. And, you know, welcome.
Yeah, big welcome to Thomas. He takes over the Epic Rhythm, and he'll be with you from 7 o'clock when the home straight ends. Well, welcome. You heard Sutumea talking about the yellow and the blue and the green, and we've just had one of them walk in. His name is Wayne Arendse. It's going to be a crazy week. Sunday you're off, well, not Sunday, but tomorrow you're off to PE. You play in the MTN8. Wednesday is the league in KZN against Maritzburg, and then Saturday you will be in Zambia to take on Zesco in the CAF Champions League. Let's start at the beginning, because when you first joined Sundowns, things didn't go so easily for you. I remember you joined with Elazar Rogers around the same time, coming from the Cape, coming from Santos. But before you got to Sundowns, where did Wayne Arendse start playing football and thought, hey, I can be a pro one day?
Yeah, I started in Cape Town, Mitchell's Plain.
That's Mitchell's Complain.
Yeah, Mitchell's Plain, the Cape Flats, as the people call it. So yeah, I started all there, and I played for a team called Kent Park. And from there, I went to Santos Juniors. And I played for them under 17, and then I got promoted to the Vodacom team, and I got promoted to the PSL team under the guidance of Rajit Desa. And from there, I played in the PSL, and next up was Sundowns.
Yeah. How vibrant is the, you know, the football, the street football scene in Mitchell's Plain? Because like a lot of people that we have here, especially the ones that are from like the townships and stuff, they always say they started playing in the townships, they started playing in the dusty streets, and how robust the football is in, you know, their respective areas. So how big and vibrant is that? Because obviously I'm not from Cape Town. I don't think Busbudu's from Cape Town either.
Yeah, obviously, wherever you go, football will always be there, no matter which part of the country in South Africa you go, whether it's Cape Town, Soweto, wherever. In Cape Town, it's nothing different, because on a Sunday afternoon, the guys are all on the field and they're making their numbers, like you're playing 5v5 or 7v7, but there's always football involved somewhere on the field, so it's all over the same.
And did you play Bay Hill back then?
Yeah, I played in the Bay Hill tournament, like... 3 or 4 times, yeah.
Yeah, and that's always a great under-19 tournament where the very best in the land play at the Bay Hill tournament. So if you are there, you already knew that, okay, one day I've got a good chance of turning professional.
Yeah, obviously, because the players who came out of the Bay Hill tournament with the likes of Benny McCarthy, Stephen Pinar, they all played there. So obviously the tournament was well-known, and because they attracted clubs from Johannesburg, and the tournament was well-known. And just to be a part of that tournament, also just to showcase your talent, it also helped you and to improve your game as well.
And tell us about the experience of playing for Santos before joining Mamelodi Sundowns, because there was a time when you played for Santos, it was after the days when Santos won the league, but there was a time when I think you guys even finished fourth with people like, was it Marwan Bantam?
Yeah, Marwan Bantam. Yeah.
Guys scoring goals and eventually moving to Pirates and so forth. And that was the golden-ish generation of Santos after the generation of the Crowe brothers and so forth. What was it like, your experience at Santos?
Yeah, obviously the experience there was actually nice, because when I started, I played with lots of experienced guys, with Idris Burton, John Makitia, Sebastian Parks.
Oh, from Mauritius, yes.
Yeah, so they were all big guys. So me, I was just looking up to them, but... When they left and they retired, we came through, like so myself, Elazar, Marwan Bantam, we all played. And we played together in the juniors. So we had that click going.
That and friendship.
Yeah. It just rubbed off to each other. So I think in that time, as you said, when they finished fourth, we did well. And I think it was just clicking in, yeah.
The CAF Champions League is the big one that's on everyone's mind. There hasn't been glory for a South African team since way back in 1995. Yes. In fact, then it wasn't even called the CAF Champions League. It was called the African Club champions or something.
And there was almost glory. There was a time when we got very close and all our hopes were up and then it just didn't quite work out. So we're hoping you guys will be the team that actually takes us there again. Yeah. The pressure.
Because we've got Magic Dust here. Sandile van Heerden will tell you about the home straight Magic Dust when he comes up to join us on stage. So then you guys finished fourth at Santos and then Santos got relegated.
Yeah.
What happened? Those must have been some tough years because as Santos was struggling and you went to the playoffs, that's the season, if I'm not mistaken, that you and Eleazar left and joined Sundowns.
Yeah, I think the season that we got relegated, it was very tough. It was tough for everyone because we started, there was quite a few new players on the scene, but we tried and every game you were pushing, but the results just didn't happen. And just sometimes, in some games, we were very unlucky. And we went to the playoffs and we just couldn't make it. And unfortunately, we got relegated. Yeah. Mm. Yeah.
Do you think that maybe even the psychology of a team that's going through like a really tough time, because sometimes you watch a team that's actually not doing well, they have a hard time coming back and like being able to fight. It's almost as if when you are in that losing streak, it's almost as if like the mentality of the players as well is in that streak. Was it the same for you guys as well?
Yeah, obviously, I can't speak for other players as well, but for me, I always told myself, listen here, if you can start just turning that corner, it just takes one game, and that's all. But there were games that we were leading, and then all of a sudden, people would score on the last minute, and you can see their heads go down.
And then you're like, no, you're getting 3 points today.
we packed the square one, and so I could see it's happening in the team. And there wasn't so much experience in the team. Like I said, Burton and those guys that have been around, they all retired. So I don't think we had enough experience to guide the youngsters through.
Mm. And then you join Mamelodi Sundowns. And that's the interesting point, because whenever players go to big clubs, let's call them the big three in South Africa, Sundowns, Chiefs and Pirates, it's not every player that will make it there. For argument's sake, you joined with Eleazar. Eleazar got some game time here and there, but eventually left. But you, your first season was tough, didn't get much game time. Yeah. And now you're a regular. How were you able to stick it out in those tough times when you were a termite there sitting chowing the bench?
At first, when I came, it was tough. I told myself, you hear your top players, your school players in the Sundowns, and you wanted to be amongst the best, so you got to work, you got to push. I wasn't in the team. I was always down, and when I came home...
Also, you miss home. You're gone from Cape Town.
You're from Cape Town.
Yeah.
Joburg.
But luckily, I had support from my wife. She was here by me, and also my family back home. They were supporting me to say, push on. You got to push. Your time will come. And I kept those words in my head, and I told myself, your time will come. So when your time comes, you need to be ready. No matter if it's tomorrow, if it's in 6 months' time, you need to be ready. So That kept me going. I think my wife and my family, they played an important role in my life. And also, all praise to God, because I always prayed in the situation that I was in. And he came through for me. We have lots of captains within the team. So I think the coach emphasizes that a lot, because he said, listen, guys, we all captain. We need to guide each other on the field. Don't just look at one guy, because we also need to instruct and bring the message across onto the field, his own message. So I think... on the leadership roles, we have enough experience on the field to guide us through.
And tell us, before we go to traffic with Vangeli Nzuza, what's it like now? You're Sundowns. You know, you're not Santos anymore, okay? Things have changed. Santos is a good team, solid team. But you're Sundowns now, you're walking in the mall. Because before you play for Santos, maybe your mother recognizes you and the
or
coach.
Maybe like in certain areas where they really support Santos.
Yeah, the real supporters
see you.
And now you're playing for Sundowns, you walk in the mall. What is that like, the star part of it? Because that surely is a little bit different. You know, you might be out with your family, for instance, going grocery shopping or whatever, and people recognize you, they stop you, they want to take photos, selfies. What's that like?
Yeah, it's a good feeling. People coming up to you, ask for your photo and so forth. But then again, it's just, you tell yourself, because you're entertaining them, and you appreciate them as well, because they support you and they recognize you and they're always there for you, man. So it's a good feeling, and What can I say? I just want to say thank you to the supporters for always being there behind us, and not just myself, but as a team as well, just to be with us and also to keep them going.
And the flip side,
I was going to ask the same. What about your family? Yeah, your wife, your kids.
Oh, I wasn't going to ask that.
Okay, no, never mind.
Okay, you can go.
All right.
Yeah. So you asking about his wife, asking, now the ladies come and
yeah,
take
well,
pictures with
them. The adjustment for the family. Because remember once we had the two kids from the national coach. Wow, I can't believe I just forgot his name. But Coach Sheikh Mashaba, his kids were here.
And they were
talking Uchabu. What it's like to be walking around with your dad. And these people are screaming at your dad. And like, all you want is to just go get a pair of socks. That's all you want in life. And these people are just not going anywhere. So on the flip side, for your family.
My family, they understand, especially my wife, because she's here with me in Johannesburg. So when we do go out in the mall and someone wants a pic, she understands because she knows the industry that we're in. And she supports me and she's very understandable.
The flip side of it is the team loses. There's Wayne Arendse going for a heavy tackle in the penalty. Ash, red card. And then penalty. Maritzburg United score. Sundowns draw 1-1 against Maritzburg. And the fans, Emmanuel, what a jesa. How do you deal with the criticism, especially from the fans? Because you know they're very vocal.
Yeah, just stay indoors. No, obviously, if you're a true fan, obviously those things happen in games. There's no team that will win every single game. You will draw some, you will lose some. But obviously the fans is out there that they know the football, they will understand. And I think those fans of Sundowns, they understand those things.
You never get down though and think, ish, man, I made such a mistake.
Yeah, obviously as a footballer, you do not want to make mistakes. And you tell yourself, hey, why did I do that mistake? But then again, you look at your videos and you tell yourself, okay, the next game I'll just be stronger.
Our sources tell us that you were once a swimmer as well.
No, Wayne. No.
Are we right?
No,
are
I can wrong? Swim, but you're wrong. Yeah.
Are we right?
Wayne Leclo.
Wayne Leclo. You've got a very busy a week ahead. Isn't there the temptation that you say, right, let's forget about this MTN 8. We see it, but we've won it before. Let's forget about this league. We see it, we've won it before. And let's focus on the CAF Champions League. Because there are some injury concerns, especially in defense. There are one or two players that were on national duty, and we're not sure what kind of shape they're in. Is there that thinking that, maybe I don't want to put all my game in against Chipa United? Let me think about Zesco, because that's my game. That's the game I want to win.
No, I don't think we're putting our priority in one game. We're looking at it at the whole. But like I said before, we're taking it one game at a time. And also saying that, if you look at it, we have like 5 weeks, then we can make history in South Africa. Because within the 5 weeks, the MTN 8 final will be there and the Champions League final. And we see ourselves in the 6 week making history in South Africa. And that's where we're taking every game as it comes and also putting 100% concentration and also focus into it. So we're not setting aside the Maritzburg game or even the Chipper game. Every game is important to us.
I remember in May, you traveled to Ghana to face Midiyama in the CAF Confederation Cup then. And I was there when guys arrived, the bus arrived, and there was all the drama the day before the game and all this and that and all of that. You can train now. No, you can't train now. No, it's our time now. And all of those mind games. And you went into that game with a 3-1 lead and eventually lost on away goals. Was that the turning point?
Yeah, I think that those were all the things that we've learned. The traveling and the conditions and what to expect in Africa. It's just a different ball game. And I think that was a turning point for us because we've learned about those things and we see ourselves back in Africa. So we had the experience going into Africa again, and I think that helped us as well because going there again, we knew what to expect, what to do, and the pitches that we're going to play on it and how to play on those pitches.
But I wanted to find out from you. You go into these tough matches, you know your team, you've studied your team. As you said, Coach Bietzel, he sits over hours and hours of videos. but it comes down to you, the players. What are the players going into in a big game like this, derby, whether it be Manchester, Soweto, or whatever, Tshwane derby? How do you guys get yourselves ready and to execute whatever plans have been put in place?
Obviously, when you play such a big game, it's every nerve is pumping in your body, and it's just that adrenaline is pumping. At the same time, you can't wait to start, because when the game starts, you forget about everything. Everything just goes silently, and then you're doing your thing. You forget about this is a big game and that. And for me personally, if we play such big games, then you try to avoid those silly mistakes. And everybody's the same, I think, because one slip up can cost the team. So I think those games, it's like normal, but everything, it just happens a bit faster. Your adrenaline is moving, and
Steven Gerrard knows that.
Yeah, sure.
From a Liverpool fan, long suffering Liverpool fan. And then obviously, I mean, we look at the sides. Someone like Sergio Aguero, he's going to miss out on this one, which obviously City fans will say is a big loss. Although Jose Mourinho has come out today saying no, and I think it's mind games, but you can tell me what you think. He says no, the Aguero loss for City actually makes things more difficult for United, because he feels they'll now come as an away opponent and play defensively and look to catch them on the break. Is it mind games? Do you think Aguero makes a huge difference?
Yeah, obviously with Aguero's presence, he's a good player, but I don't think it'll be such a big difference, because you have other players as well, that Sterling is there, and they have quality players. So I think it's all mind games, because both these coaches, they've been there and they know how to
work. And they love each other, we know that.
They know how to work the media as well, and just to play those mind games. So I definitely think it's a mind game that's playing it.